Good morning, welcome to King's Cross. Would you all please join together in song?
By faith we see the hand of God. In the light of creation's grand design. In the lives of those who prove his faithful. By faith and not by sight. By faith our fathers hold the earth with the power of his promise in their hearts. Of a holy city built by God's own hand. A place where peace and justice reign.
Church was called to grow
in the power of the Spirit to the lost, to deliver captives and to preach in every corner of the earth.
Hey, good morning. Welcome to King's Cross Church. My name is Paul. I'm one of the pastors here. I'm so glad you would join us online to worship with us this Sunday, or whenever it is that you're watching this. It was so good also to see many of you in person last Sunday. It really was. And in this time of increased isolation and disruption, and how long this has gone, our times in person together, whenever we can get them, have become even more precious and joyous. We hope to gather in person more often as the temperatures cool down a little bit, and we'll tell you more about that as we're able to secure those locations as plans unfold. Hey, this season of pandemic, it really has been a lot of ups and downs, and maybe for a lot of us more downs, if anything else. And it can feel at times like a storm, because things just are out of control. Like with a storm, things are beyond what you can do. And Jesus' disciples also experienced that as well. They experienced what the storm was when they were rowing across a lake one night, across the Sea of Galilee, in fact, after a long, hard day dealing with needy people, when a massive storm hit while they were on the water. Now, and from the beginning of time, sea has always is represented almost transculturally, universally, sea has represented evil, it's represented chaos, death, danger. And it's even given divine characteristics by many pagan religions. This sea, and the sea in general, was feared universally, even by the Romans who ruled the world at that time. These disciples knew that storm might be the end of them. But in this biblical, in the biblical context, in the creation account we see in Genesis, we see God having total control over the chaos, over the waters. We see Him speaking, and chaos turns into order. This theme runs throughout Scripture in Noah's account with the flood, with Israel and Egypt's encounter with the Red Sea, all through the Psalms and on through the Gospels and even through 2 Peter, and then even on into Revelation, where we hear about a day when there will be no longer any sea. Not mentioning that there will be no more water, but that there will be no more chaos, death, and evil. For the old way things were will have come and gone. Well, the disciples in the storm were scared. They were yelling at one another. They were yelling at Jesus even to wake Him up, asking, Jesus, do you even care that we're suffering the way we are in this storm? But then Jesus showed them that He did care. And He showed them power like they had never seen before. Power none of them could imagine. Power that only the pagan religions dared speak of against this evil, formidable foe. Power over the wind and waves themselves. The furious storm stopped at Jesus' command. Their rabbi, Jesus, their master, showed Himself more powerful than all those pagan deities, even the Roman gods. Jesus did care about His disciples. And He does today care about you and me and the storm we're enduring right now. In fact, He cares enough to lead us, get this, into the storm, knowing that sometimes it's only through the storms that we can begin to see Jesus as He truly is, as the Lord of all and the lover of our souls, as the one, as the living water that can only, the only one who can truly satisfy our thirst as we live in a world that tries to offer us comfort in so many other different ways. On the cross, too, Jesus later endured the greatest storm that anyone could ever truly imagine. The storm of all storms, after all, isn't weather-related. It's our sense of impending judgment and doom for what we've done, the wrongs we've done, for our sin. In the Bible, that's even symbolized by a lake of fire. And that storm of all storms killed, it crushed Jesus on that cross. Utterly demoralized, His disciples buried Him in the ground and went to hide. But on the third day, Jesus rose from the dead. He once again proved His ultimate lordship, this time conquering over sin and death. Brothers and sisters in Christ, and those even who are listening in, who are trying to check out what Christianity is all about, hear this. We're all about this Jesus, who's the only one who has power over all these things, who's our only true anchor in the midst of the storm. And in this world that is broken and still waiting for redemption, He is the one who can be our true hope, and He is a glorious hope. Not only powerful, but the lover of our souls. And so let's lean in closer to Jesus in this time of storm and interruption. Let's lean into Him this morning. Learn more about who He is, who His Father is, and who His Spirit, who dwells within us, is. And we're excited to have the Reverend Jeff Lee preach for us this morning. Jeff is coming back to preach for us. He preached last for us in person at Stonebridge High School, and he's going to preach for us now on our video this morning. He's the campus director of Reformed University Fellowship at Christopher Newport University. We're glad to have him back. Jeff, it'll be great to see you here in a moment. But hey, guys, let's pray as we begin our worship service. Heavenly Father, we thank You that You are indeed Lord of all, but not just Lord at a distance, but Lord who would come and take on flesh and even sit in a boat with us, with Your disciples, and cause storms to cease. Father, we ask that You would make us aware of Your presence among us by Your Spirit this morning, that You would, no matter what it is we're going through or facing, no matter what we may be anxious about, or even whatever we're celebrating, that we can know that there is nothing truly greater than You. Be our anchor, be our all in all. In Jesus' name we pray, and for His glory. Amen. Amen. Well, as we begin our service, would you read with me, and let's do a call back and forth, our call to worship this morning, which is from Psalm 32. Would you read this with me? I'll read first. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance, Selah. Read together with me. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. Amen. Let us worship him in song.
What love could remember no wrongs we have done? Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. trumpet sound. May I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Faultless to stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone. Weak and made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all.
Hi, my name is Emily Engel. Please join me in reading this morning's scriptural confession of faith from Ephesians 2, 1 through 7. We believe in God the Father, rich in mercy, who, because of his great love for us, made us alive with Christ his Son, even when we were dead in trespasses and sins in which we once walked, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind. It is by grace we have been saved. We believe God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Jesus Christ, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Amen.
As could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, by example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed, living he loved.
One day the grave could conceal him.
Hey, if you're just now tuning in, thank you for joining us here at King's Cross. We're so glad you'd make worshiping with us a part of your weekend, whenever it is that you are tuning in. We're glad you could join us. I have just a couple announcements. One, hey, Backpack Buddies are going back to school. Our students that we have supported are going back to school now, and we have a new sign-up list that you can help fill up. We have these students that struggle with low food insecurity. The school district helps them Monday through Friday with lots with food, but we also have found that they need extra groceries for the weekend, and that's a way that we can just simply support them. It doesn't take much, doesn't really cost that much, but it's a very simple way we can connect with local families and love where we live. It's very simple. Just go to kingscrossva.org. And on the homepage, right there, you don't even have to scroll down. Under the first link on how to live stream, there's another link that talks about feeding local families. And you just click on that. It'll take you to our sign-up genius. And once you're there, you can sign up for one or two or five or 10 of the spots. There are 88 spots. I think we already have 30 or so filled up. We just opened it up last week. And so please do go and see if that's something that you're able to do. Hey, we're excited to have, again, the Reverend Jeff Lee preach for us this Sunday. He's the campus director at RUF, Reformed University Fellowship, at Christopher Newport University. And he's joined us before in person. He's joining us now over video. But we are still excited to have Jeff preach for us this morning. As we worship in song and in prayer and also by hearing God's word and reflecting on that, worshiping him with our attention this morning, we also worship in our giving, and that's something you can do now or throughout the week. You can even set up regular giving, as many people in our church do, I know. You can do that at kingscrossva.org/give. And we give because we know that God's given all we have to us. We give that what is given might go to the advancement of God's kingdom. Strategically, we gather and budget this money to go to make impact here in Ashburn and in the greater Loudoun County area. So giving is still important, especially as we start this new ministry year. We're very excited about it. All the Bible studies that will start, all the things that will kick off that we'll tell you more about. Giving is still important, so please consider doing that. And also, please let us know If you are ever facing financial hardship, in need of anything, if there's any way we can help, reach out to me, to someone in our church office or our staff, and let us know how we can see about we can help. Would you pray with me? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful to be able to gather, even though it is online, and we are so grateful to be able to gather together last Sunday. It was so nice to see everyone's, not everyone I know, but so many friendly faces. And we look forward to the day when there will be nothing to encumber us, to hinder us from all meeting together. Father, we long for that day and pray that you would cause this pandemic to come to an abrupt end, that you would cause the spread of COVID to stop. Father, that, and yet that somehow you would use this storm that we're in for your glory and to show people who you really are, to be the Lord and lover of our souls. Father, we ask for those who are traveling and those who are taking last-minute vacations. Keep them safe on the road, we pray. Father, we pray for those experiencing any kind of fear for maybe having been exposed, that, Father, you would help us as we quarantine ourselves, calm our anxieties, and turn to you in all these things. Help us to be good about taking precautions and loving our neighbor in that way. Father, I pray for parents of students. I pray for students. I pray for teachers, school administrators, for those who are wrestling and working through the opening of school coming soon with all of these extra things going on. I know it can be incredibly stressful for so many. Father, I pray that you would bless our teachers, bless our administrators. Bless parents as they consider how this is going to work into their schedule. Provide for us financially, Father, and I'm sure many of us are feeling, might be wondering how that's going to happen. Father, show yourself to be good in the midst of all of this storm. And Father, use this time somehow to even bring your church closer together and to bring people into a knowledge of your love and your saving grace through your church, through your people. I pray for healthcare workers, protect them, keep them safe. Thank you for them. I pray for those facing financial hardship. Father, help us connect and help us help in whatever way we can. Father, we want to give to you just a small portion of what you've given to us. And so what we give to you, we dedicate and ask that you would multiply it and cause it to multiply your kingdom. And your kingdom, Father, cannot always be seen. Your kingdom, Father, sometimes it has signs that we can see. Sometimes it's things that we can't see, like hearts changing, like homes and environments, home environments changing because of the grace of Jesus at work. Father, would you do these huge things? May your gospel go forth. May we not settle for a Christianity that looks good on the outside. But Father, may we each hunger to dig deeply into your word, to dig deeply to know you, and to be changed by your word rather than puffed up by it. Father, we pray that we would not settle for trying to simply to have all of our things together, because Father, we never can. But Father, help us rather to get better at turning to you in times of need. To be better at relying on you when we feel our patience tested. To be better at relying on you when our finances are stretched. To be better at turning to you and praising you when you come through. Father, we pray all this and ask that you speak through Jeff this morning. May your gospel go forth. Father, one last thing also for those who are expecting, who are pregnant. I pray especially for Christina McCall and as she nears her last days. Father, we pray that for your protection and health for her and for her baby. Father, we ask all this for your glory in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. All right, now we're going to hear. Here is Jeff Lee, Reverend Jeff Lee, campus director. Jeff, bring us the word.
Hey, well, good morning, everybody. My name is Jeff Lee. I'm the RUF campus minister at Christopher Newport University. And it's a privilege I get to preach to you all, albeit that it's virtual and not in person. Good news is the Holy Spirit is still at work, whether virtually or in person. And he's going to speak to us through his word no matter what. So it's a privilege to be here with you. So thank you for having me and allowing me to pinch hit for Paul this morning. But if you have your Bibles with you, if you'll open up to the book of Judges, we are going to look at a great story in the book of Judges, in Judges chapter 4, verses 1 through 24, and we're going to see the story of Deborah, who's the only female judge to lead the nation of Israel. But we're going to see in this story some really, really amazing things of God's provision, of his care, of him bringing provision and protection when his people are going through chaotic times. And we're also going to be able to just see some graphic details that you might not think pop up in the Bible. There's some crazy things that we see in this story that I think are going to grip you and actually like grab your attention a little bit. But really the most important thing is we see a God who listens to his people, who hears their cries, and he responds and provides. And right now, as we're going through chaotic times, experiencing all of the wrath of COVID-19, we need to be reminded that our God is listening, that God hears our prayers, he responds and protects his people when we cry out to him. And so we see some of these major themes in this passage. But I don't want to spoil anything, so let's just dive right in, because there's a lot here. Open up your Bibles to Judges chapter 4, and let's look at verses 1 through 24, and I'm going to read starting in verse 1. Here we go. And the people of Israel again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord after the former judge Ehud had died. And the Lord sold Israel into the hand of Jabin, the king of Canaan, who reigned in Hazor. Now the commander of the Canaanite army was named Sisera, and he lived in a place called Harosheth Hagoyim. Then the people of Israel, they cried out to the Lord for help, because the Canaanite general in this army had 900 chariots of iron, and Sisera, the Canaanite general, oppressed the people of Israel cruelly for 20 years. Now Deborah, a prophetess, the wife of Lapidoth, was judging Israel at that time, and she used to sit under the palm of Deborah between Ramah and Bethel, and the hill country of Ephraim, and the people of Israel came up to her for judgment for civil matters. Well, then Deborah sent and summoned for a guy named Barak, the son of Abinoam, who's from Kadesh Naphtali, and she said to him, "Has not the Lord, the God of Israel, commanded you to go and gather the men at Mount Tabor, taking 10,000 warriors from the tribe of Naphtali and the tribe of Zebulun, and that I, the Lord, will draw out Sisera, the general of Jabin's army, to meet you by the river Kishon with his chariots and his troops, and I, the Lord, will give him into your hand?" And Barak said to Deborah, "Well, if you will go with me, I will go, but if you will not go with me, I will not go." And so she said to Barak, "I will surely go with you, but nevertheless, the road in which you are going on, it will not lead to your glory, for the Lord will sell Sisera into the hand of a woman." Then Deborah arose and went with Barak to Kadesh. And Barak called out the tribes of Zebulun and Naphtali to the place called Kadesh. And 10,000 warriors went up at his heels, and Deborah went with them. Now Heber the Kenite had separated from the Kenites, the descendants of Hobab, the father-in-law of Moses, and had pitched his tent as far away as the oak of Zananim, which is near a place called Kadesh. Now when Sisera was told that Barak, the son of Abinoam, had gone to Mount Tabor, Sisera called out all of his chariots, 900 chariots of iron, and all of his men who were with him to go from Harosheth Hagoyim to the river Kishon. And Deborah said to Barak, "Up, this is the day in which the Lord has given Sisera into your hand. Does not the Lord go out before you?" So Barak went down from Mount Tabor with his 10,000 warriors following after him. And the Lord routed Sisera and all of his chariots and all of his army before Barak by the edge of the sword. And Sisera got down from his chariot and fled away on foot. And Barak pursued the chariots and the army all the way to Harosheth Hagoyim, and all the army of Sisera, the Canaanite army, fell by the edge of the sword, not a man was left. Verse 17, but Sisera fled away on foot to the tent of Jael, the wife of Heber the Kenite, for there was peace between Jabin the king of Hazor and the house of Heber the Kenite. And Jael came out to meet Sisera and said to him, "Turn aside, my lord, Turn aside, do not be afraid. Then so Sisera turned aside to her and went into the tent, and she covered him with a rug. And he said to her, please give me a little water to drink. I am thirsty. So she opened a skin of milk and gave him a drink and covered him. He said to her, please stand at the tent, right? The opening of the tent. And if any man comes and asks of you, is anyone here? Please say no. But Jael, the wife of Heber, instead took a tent peg and took a hammer in her hand. Then she went softly to Sisera while he was lying fast asleep from weariness. And she drove from the hammer to the tent peg into his temple. So he died just like that. And behold, as Barak was pursuing Sisera, Jael went out to meet Barak and said to him, come in, I will show you the man whom you are seeking. So Barak went into Jael's tent, and there lay Sisera dead with the tent peg in his temple. So on that day God subdued Jabin the king of Canaan before the people of Israel, and the hand of the people of Israel pressed harder and harder against Jabin the king of Canaan until he finally destroyed Jabin the king of Canaan and all of his army. The clearest image that comes to mind to me when I first read this passage were those t-shirts and belt buckles that say, don't mess with Texas, right? Because if you grab the bull, you might get the horns. Well, in our story, it's don't mess with God's ladies, Deborah or Jael, and certainly don't mess with God, because if you do, you might get a tent peg in your temple, right? It's graphic, I know, but that's what's in the story, right? And so this is divine justice bearing down on God's enemies, and particularly a very cruel and womanizing right enemy of God in the form of the general Sisera. And so we see some graphic imagery, right? We certainly see some militaristic battles in this story as well. And I'll tell you, if you're thinking, oh man, I don't know about this guy Sisera getting a tent peg in his temple, trust me, you'll see by the end of the story, this is justice that he's getting, actually, right? And so you won't feel too bad for him at the end of the story. But what are we seeing? Well, we're seeing verses 1 through 3, a cycle of sin and mercy. The Bible tells us the people of Israel, again, right, repetitive nature, they again did what was evil in the sight of the Lord after their godly judge and leader, Ehud, after he died. After he died, they fell apart, and they're, right, going after other idols, Baal, Canaanite gods, and they're following them instead of following Yahweh, right? They're coping with their situation following false gods, and so that's what's happening. They're doing evil in the sight of God in all sorts of creative, sinful ways, and because they as a people were engaging in national, right, habitual sins, the Lord sells them into the hand of the Canaanite king Jabin, who's reigning in a place called Hazor. So this is godly discipline that's actually he's administering over his people, right? It's actually out of care for the people, not out of just disdain or anything like that. So I liken it to when my son, who's six, when he darts towards the road, which in front of my house is a busy road, I discipline my son. Because he darted out towards the road, right? Whether it's to grab a ball or frisbee or whatever he was going after. And I instill the fear of the Lord in him. And I do that discipline, because I love him and I want to preserve his life, right? Physically. Well, in this situation, God is disciplining his children, his nation, to preserve their eternal lives, because they're following after false gods, which leads to eternal death. But so what he happens to do is disciplining them by using another nation to show them and oppress them in such a way that they will actually see their need of their God Yahweh, and they'll finally realize, whoa, these false gods that we're worshiping, they're actually not very powerful, they're not very good, and they certainly don't deliver on their promises. And so God is actually doling out temporary, right, kind of discipline so that there might be eternal life. They might see their evil ways and turn away from them and turn to the Lord. And so we see this on a national scale happening. And we know that because in verse 3, the people of Israel cried out to the Lord. It took them 20 years of being cruelly oppressed, but it took 20 years. But He cry out, Lord, help us. And when they do, what does the Lord do? He shows his kindness and his mercy to his people. He provides for them another godly leader in the form of Deborah. So this godly woman is provided for them to give them godly leadership so that they might return back to God and actually be freed from this foreign oppression. And verses 4 through 9, this is where we see Deborah come onto our scene. And it describes her as a prophetess, one who hears from the Lord and speaks from the Lord, as a mother of Israel, one who is caring for all of her people. And we even know that there's a place named after her, the Palm of Deborah, that it's actually a location where she would sit and judge civil matters for her people and for the tribes of Israel. And so she would dole out justice and equity to her people, and she was revered and loved. She's actually the only judge in the book of Judges who's talked about in such a high way that she does not have any major glaring character flaws that the other judges have. And so she's actually this distinct, unique judge among the other 12 judges in the book of Judges. So, unique person we're dealing with, a very godly lady who's leading the nation of Israel in this time of chaos that the Lord raises up for them. But a really legit question to ask is, well, how did she know after 20 years of oppression it's time to rise up against our foreign oppressors, Canaan, and fight them? We don't know if the Lord came to her and spoke to her through a dream, or if an angel of the Lord spoke to her, or if it was just a gut feeling that the people of God were repenting and uniting together and turning back to God, that now it's time. Maybe all of the above. We don't know exactly. But clearly she knows from the Lord that it's time to go. It's time to fight, and that God is with us. He's going to give us freedom. He's going to provide order in the chaos. And so she calls out this leader, Barak, to gather 10,000 men from two tribes of Israel to actually then go up and war against Sisera and his army. And so that's what we see. Deborah asks Barak, she says, has not the Lord, the God of Israel, commanded you to go and gather, right, these men, these 10,000 warriors from these two tribes, and that I, the Lord, will be the one to draw Sisera out, right, and actually bring him and deliver him to the river Kishon. And actually, when he gets there, I'm going to be the one, the Lord, to deliver you victory. I'm going to deliver him and his army and his modern technology, right, these iron chariots. I'm going to gift these things to you, and you will have victory over them. And Barak's response is, well, I'm not going to go unless you, Deborah, come with me, right? Unless I have my covering, right, my daughter, which she will not go anywhere unless she has her blankie with her to feel safe. Barak's like, unless you come with me, right, and you become and you are our blankie for nation Israel because you seem to have God's favor, unless you come, I'm not going to go. But if you do come, I'll go, and we will mount up for war. And so she says, I will go with you. I will be with you, and I will be with the men, and the Lord will be with us. So she's just exemplifying great confidence in the Lord and also what he's going to do on behalf of the cries of the people, providing mercy for her people. And so this is what we begin to see. Now, you might think that Barak is maybe a little cowardly, that he has to have this woman come with him. But also maybe it's not just cowardice, but also maybe it's a little bit of wisdom. Right, the Lord has clearly showed his favor upon her. So maybe it's both, right? Maybe it's a little bit of cowardice, but also maybe a little bit of wisdom, because God's clearly with this woman in very powerful ways, using her in very godly ways. But that's exactly why she says to Barak, this is not going to lead, though. Even though you're going to be the guy leading the army, and you're going to be the general of the army, when you have victory, you're not going to be the one who gets the name and all the acclaim that comes with it. It's actually going to be a woman. And I don't know if that's because of lack of faith, might be, but clearly that's being told to him, that even though the general typically gets the glory, he's not going to get the glory. It's going to be another woman that the Lord's actually going to do a great work of justice through. So that's made explicit in our passage. But what we begin to see now in verses 10 through 13 is an amassing of two armies. If you like The Lord of the Rings like I do, if you've seen the movie Two Towers, right, the second movie in Lord of the Rings trilogy, you begin to remember, whoa, there's an amassing of armies at Helm's Deep. On one side, you have the orcs, right, and Saruman and his army. And on the other end, you have, right, the elves and the armies of men amassing together in order to have this massive fight and war. Right, and that's exactly what's kind of happening here in verses 10 through 13. And that's the imagery I like to draw on for us to understand that the Israelite army and the Canaanite army are coming together to fight a very, very massive battle. And so that's what we have here. And when Barak brings all of his men, 10,000 men from two tribes, Naphtali, right, and certainly Zebulun, what you see is then even Sisera, he catches wind of this massing army. He's like, well, I'm going to gather my men together and also my armored death machines, these armored chariots, and we're going to go and we're going to prepare for battle. And that's exactly what happens here. And you would think, though, that the advantage would be Canaan, because they might have more than 10,000 men, which is likely. And they also have essentially modern tanks. And you have Israel on the other side that has pitchforks. And so you think advantage would go to Sisera and his army, right, with their modern advanced weaponry and their tanks against Israel that has pitchforks and swords, right? Well, you would think that, and I could understand why Barak might be a little skittish to go into this battle. But the reality is, God is not afraid of, right, Canaan's advanced weaponry. Not at all. They maybe have, right, mobile armored death machines, but the Israelites have the Almighty God, creator of the universe, right, who's in charge of all things, the wind, the seas, the sun, the moon, right, all natural elements and all things. He's on their side. So actually, advantage, Israelites, and not Canaan. But you would see that. That's why our author gives us so many details, and he says over and over, 900 chariots of iron, because the author wants you to understand this, that when Israel is going up against this probably larger army and more advanced army, it's a pretty scary sight. They may be going to imminent death, right? So, but the reality is God's with them, so it's not as bleak as it would seem. But from human standards, right, we might think that. Well, the good news is verses 14 through 16 tell us we have a divine warrior who fights on our behalf, that we have a God who loves us and who fights for us and fights for our heart's affections, and that's exactly what we see. We see in verse 14, Deborah says to Barak, she says, "Up, for this is the day in which the Lord has given Sisera into your hand. Does not the Lord go before you?" He does. Right? So Barak went from Mount Tabor with his 10,000 warriors following him, and the Lord routed Sisera, right, and all of his chariots and all of his army before Barak by the edge of the sword, and not a man was left. And then Sisera, as a coward, he flees on foot after he sees we've lost the battle, all of the men are dying, so he flees away, all the way, right, traveling to what he thinks is an ally. He thinks that Heber is an ally of his, which at that time, this guy Heber, that's why he's mentioned in the story, he is an ally of Canaan. And so he thinks, as I'm traveling and fleeing from this battle, if I can just get to an ally's house, maybe they can protect me, provide for me a little bit. And that's what happens. That's exactly what happens. But we see that in just a moment. But before that happens, I want to bring out a phrase that's very loaded. When the Bible says that the Lord routed Sisera, I want you to know that there's a lot going on there. When actually in chapter 5, Judges chapter 5, verses 20 through 21, Deborah describes exactly what that means by the Lord routed Sisera. And so let me just share with you, this is her singing a song of victory after this battle about what's happening right here in this routing of the army. She sings loud and proud, "From the heavens the stars fought. From their courses they fought against Sisera, and the torrent Kishon swept them away. The ancient torrent, the torrent Kishon, march on my soul with might, right? So Deborah is singing that the Lord, as divine warrior, he routed the Canaanites and their modern, right, armored death machines and their larger army. He routed them, and that basically means that the river Kishon, which the Lord brought this army to, it was flooding. And the floodwaters were rendering all these chariots useless, because obviously if there's thick mud, well, the chariots can't zip and zoom in the thick mud. And the reason why this is such a big deal is because God, as he brings this enemy to the river, then he floods the river. We have to ask, well, by what means did he flood the river? Obviously by rain. Well, then you might want to ask, well, isn't the Canaanite god Baal, isn't he an ancient fertility rain god pretty much? He is, right? The Canaanites worshiped Baal and all sorts of different rituals, usually sexualized rituals, hoping that he would then rain down rain and produce their right good crops, which would lead to right an abundance of their civilization and so forth. But essentially, this idea that the Canaanite god's superpower is rain, it's interesting that God actually uses rain to render his enemies and their advanced technology worthless. So God shows himself supreme, that he's the only God, the true God, taking this foreign god's superpower and weaponizing it against them in a really cool way. That's exactly what's happening here. The Lord routed Sisera. The Lord worked on behalf of his people who had less and who are weaker to show himself strong by destroying this army, right, that actually utilized their advanced tech and looked to themselves and looked to false gods for victory. And God showed himself, I'm number one, not Baal. And so we see that in a very prominent way in this passage. And so that's really what's going on. God's fighting for his people and for the affection of his people and for the freedom of his people. But there's still one problem. Even though this army is decimated, their cruel ruler, Sisera, is getting away. He's fleeing on foot, right? Well, the Lord's going to exact divine justice on him too. And that's exactly what we see in verses 17 through 22. He thinks that after hoofing it, possibly for hours or maybe days, that when he gets to his ally's house, Heber's house, that he can rest. He can slow down. He can get fed. He can maybe sleep. He'd get sleep and he'd get rest, but it would be a final rest, right? And a final sleep that he would get, because it is a false sense of security. What we see actually, though, even though Heber has maybe sold his soul to Canaan, Jalel very much still, right, worships Yahweh the Lord. And so we see the Lord work through this housewife in a really kind of powerful way to bring about divine justice on this cruel, womanizing Canaanite leader, Sisera. And that's exactly what we have here. We have her, right, say, hey, come in, don't worry, right? I'll protect you. I'll throw a rug over you. It's going to be okay. And I'm not even going to give you water. I'm going to do one better. I'm going to give you from a nobleman's bowl some food and some milk, and here's a place to rest. And your request of having me stand at the tent in case there happen to be some Israelite army men come by, no problem. I'll tell them you're not here. So it's going to be okay. She gives and provides a false sense of security. But as soon as Sisera sleeps, she takes a workman's mallet and a hammer and a tent peg and drives it into his temple and his skull, crushing it, right? And instantaneously, he dies. And so she's actually exacting final justice for God onto this man. And that's exactly what happens. In chapter 5 of the book of Judges, this is Deborah singing. She sings, most blessed woman be Jael, the wife of Heber the Kenite, of tent-dwelling women most blessed. Sisera asked for water. She gave him milk. She brought him curds in a nobleman's bowl. And she also sent her hand to the tent peg and her right hand to the workman's mallet and struck Sisera, crushed his head, and shattered and pierced his temple. End of lyric, right? Catchy tune, huh? Well, that's what's being celebrated, this divine justice. The reason why I said in the very beginning, if you think, man, Sisera is getting a raw deal here with a tent peg in his temple, you would be wrong. Because what is not told in Judges chapter 4, but it's alluded to in Judges chapter 5, verses 30 and following, is the fact that Sisera not only is a cruel oppressor of people, right, for many, many years, torturing them, right, stealing from them, he's also a womanizer who's raping and pillaging people also too. Because actually what's said in the Song of Deborah in chapter 5 is that Sisera's mom is waiting for Sisera to return from battle with the spoils of war, which would be filled wombs, and also clothing from the women that he either murdered or raped, right? And that the mom of Sisera is going to get a new wardrobe. She's waiting for him. Maybe new grandchildren and new clothing. That's pretty sick, right? But that's what she's waiting for him to come back. I don't know if this was just a normalcy, but certainly that's what she was anticipating. So you have a rapist, person pillaging, stealing, cruelly oppressing the people. And it's interesting. God has a unique, right, just beautiful sense of humor, but he's also a God of justice. And that he uses a woman to actually bring about justice to this womanizer. That's what happens here in this story. So we don't have to feel really bad for Sisera. He's a horrible human being. But what we see in this story is this act of justice, this act of provision, caring for God's people, wiping out this army, is actually a great win for God's people, right? And this is a great win where justice prevailing against foreign gods, foreign nations, godlessness, and certainly all sorts of despicable evils. That's what's happening. God is administering, even if it's temporary justice, a sense of justice. And that's what we see. And Deborah leads the people of God in continual worship of Yahweh, and they have 40 years of peace as a result of repenting of their sin, repenting of their following false gods, and returning back to Yahweh. And then they have peace under her leadership and in their faithfulness to God for a time. But what's unique about this is the people of God, they don't deserve any better than the Canaanites. They really don't. They were doing evil following Baal just like the Canaanites were. So they deserved divine punishment. But what did God give his people who cried out to him? What did he give his people because he's given his covenants to them? He gave them mercy, not justice. Reality is you in the story are a part of the Israelites, right? Like you are the Israelites. I'm the Israelites. I have to read myself into that story as the Israelites, and I deserve God's divine justice. But the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ is I get mercy, not justice. My sin, the wages of my sin is death, eternal death. But because of Jesus Christ taking on that wrath on the cross, I get mercy. These people, they get mercy, even though they don't deserve it. That's good news. And so when we ask ourselves a couple of questions, looking at a story like this, it's not who is God calling me to drive a tent peg into. That's not a right application. But a right question in this kind of story is, how am I turning away from the Lord like the Israelites? How are my heart's affections far away from the Lord? How am I turning to other coping mechanisms other than the Lord? What am I turning to, whether it's a person or a thing, other than God to try to cope with the chaos that I'm in right now? Because you are. Not every compartment of your heart is 100% devoted to God. That's true of my heart. Even though I don't want it to be, it's true. It's true of yours as well. How are you turning away from the Lord? How have you been turning away from the Lord? How have you been coping with the COVID-19 chaos that you're going through? but turning to other things other than the Lord. What is it? And are you recognizing that need for the Lord, crying out to the Lord for help? Are you becoming more codependent on the Lord, saying, Lord, help me, give me freedom from this thing that's oppressing me, this sin, this coping strategy or mechanism, this desire that I can't free from? Lord, can you free me from it? The Lord can. He's a divine warrior who fights for his people and fights for his heart's affections, and he'll do it. He loves you. He loves his people. I think another viable question for us to ask is also, because we have a God who fights for us, is where do you want to see him fight for you? Where do you want to see change, growth, healing in your life? God loves his people. Sometimes we don't have because we don't ask. Where do you want to see change in your life, growth, healing in your life? Your God loves you. He sent his only son to the cross to provide for you, not just eternal salvation, but also to give you hope, to give you peace, to give you comfort, to give you himself, his presence, his spirit, to also give you even temporary good things, sometimes like peace or comfort, or his people, or a temporary provision, protection, whatever it might be. Where do you want to see him fight for you, provide for you, heal you, change you for good? Because God delights to show himself strong to his people who are weak. Where do you want to see God move in your life? He'll move on your behalf. Ask. Engage him in prayer. And then the last thing I want to ask you, kind of anticipation of this, is also, how are you celebrating God's faithfulness? Even though we're going through chaotic times, God is faithful. He's good. And just like he was faithful to provide this military victory and provide peace for his people, God has been showing himself in all sorts of little ways, but maybe even big ways, himself faithful to you during this time of chaos. And are you celebrating those things? Are you thanking the Lord for his faithfulness, for his provision, for his protection, for his care? Are you bearing witness to that faithfulness to your children, to your friends, to your community? Because I'll tell you, times are hard, but God has been faithful. Are you celebrating that? We should be a people who celebrate. We have much to celebrate. This isn't the end. Even if the worst of COVID-19 takes us from this life, guess what? We get eternal life with God. Jesus said to the thief on the cross, "Today you will be with me in paradise." So even if the horrors and the ravaging nature of COVID-19 took us from, right, this temporary space, we would be in paradise. I don't want any of that for us right now, but I'm saying that's still good news. So there's an eternal perspective that God provides. God cares for his people temporally and eternally. We have much to celebrate. The good news is also God poured out his Holy Spirit to be with us. With is one of the greatest prepositions in the Bible because God is with us now. He has never left us. And even now we have his Spirit residing in us. Those who love Jesus, love God, and turn to him for their hope and for their truth and for their salvation. So we have much to celebrate, God being with us now. He's going to be with us when we meet him on the other side of the grave, and he hears our cries and our pleas, and he provides. So my friends, there is much for us to learn, even from these historical narratives, of God's character, his faithfulness, and his love for you, and that God provides for his people. And thank God we get mercy and not justice, even though we deserve it. So we have much to be thankful for. Our God is faithful and he is good. Amen. Well, let me tell you, think on these things, ask some of these hard questions, and saturate your mind on this passage this week, on Judges chapter 4. Come back to this passage this week and look at how God is faithful to his people and how he's faithful to you, and celebrate that because he is. Sometimes we need that perspective, even when we go through hard things, that our God is with us and that he hears us. Well, I wish I could be with you. Love you guys, but may the Lord be with you. May he encourage you. May he strengthen you. Join me in prayer. Lord, you are faithful to us even though we go through these crazy times. We don't know what tomorrow holds, but we know that you are faithful, Lord. You've been faithful, Lord, in the past. You're faithful now in the present. We know you're going to be faithful in the future. Lord, thank you for that. Thank you that you are a divine warrior who fights for, Lord, fights for his people. You fight for our heart's affections. And Lord, that you truly bring change. You truly do provide and work on our behalf to bring freedom. Freedom from oppression, freedom from sin, freedom from things that haunt us in our past. You give us freedom and you give us peace. Bring those things to our heart now, Lord, as we experience chaos. We need you. We need your spirit, Lord. We need your wisdom. We need your word. Show up in really powerful ways. Lord, we love you. Lord, we thank you for all that you've done for us. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, dying on the cross for our salvation and for our provision, Lord. We love you. And all God's people said, amen. Amen, guys.
And thank you, Jeff. Thank you for that. Hey, everybody, we have a confession of sin written out. It's actually quoting Psalm 38, and I invite you to read this aloud with me. It's fairly simple, fairly short, and gets to the point, and I pray it would stir our hearts in response to God's amazing word that has power to shape and change and instruct and comfort us. So let's pray this together. We confess our iniquity. We are sorry for our sin. Do not forsake us, O Lord. O our God, be not far from us. Make haste to help us, O Lord, our salvation. Amen. Amen. Let's take a moment of silent prayer and confession right now. Father, you have searched us and you know us, and I pray you continue to do that and make us aware of ways that we need to be changed. And whenever that happens, it's always disruptive, Father, I know, but it always hurts to see our sin. But Father, as you show us, fill us and change us that we might live more and more in repentance and faith and trust and joy and hope and help us to know as you change us, that our sins are forgiven because of Christ. It's in Jesus' name and his forgiveness, and for his sake we pray. Amen. Now hear this assurance of pardon. This is actually from Psalm 32, another psalm. It just says this, and I'll just read the psalm. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. For when I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer. Selah. I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord. And you forgave the iniquity of my sin. This is good news. Let us worship our Savior in song.
I am forgiven. The
King of Kings calls me his own. A beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
This good news, this benediction as we go our ways. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Thanks for worshiping with us. Have a great week. God bless. Down from glory.
my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. A beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. Silence.